Welcome to the week ending January 16th, 1943. My name is Henry Chapp. Tonight we are going to listen to World News Today, the Al Jolson Show Suspense and Command Performance. It all begins in just a little bit. If you love the World War II era, consider following us on Patreon. You not only support this channel, but you will get daily posts of pop culture and a daily newspaper in chronological order. It's neat to follow the war as your parents, grandparents, or even your great-grandparents have followed it. Check us out with a one-week free trial. A link is in the comments to this video. In our first hour tonight, we are going to listen to World News Today from January 10th, 1943. We have to find out what is going on at Stalingrad, North Africa, and Guadalcanal. Following the news, it's the Al Jolson Show, sponsored by Colgate, from January 12th, 1943. Jolson at one time was considered the greatest entertainer of his generation. But by 1943, his prime had passed, and he was more of a nostalgia act. A lot of older people of the time and still enjoyed his program. On his show is Robert Benchley. He was a humorist and was famous for his columns in The New Yorker. He did some acting also and was in Alfred Hitchcock's film Foreign Correspondent. Let's turn on this old tube radio, that's our time machine, and give this stuff a listen.
World News Today, brought to you by Continental Radio and Television Corporation, makers of Admiral Radio, America's smart set. By shortwave broadcast, direct from important overseas capitals, as well as the leading news centers of our own country, CBS correspondents are waiting to bring you a complete report from the world's political and battlefronts. But first, here's John Daly.
On all the far-flung battlefronts of this war, initiative from the Axis powers. Land forces of the United Nations no longer dive instinctively for the foxholes when planes roar overhead, for most of them are Allied planes. This single factor, perhaps more than any other, has put the United Nations on the offensive. In North Africa, in both Libya and Tunisia, the story of the fighting is principally the story of air fighting, of Allied planes methodically hammering at Axis supply ports and Axis supply lines. American bombers from Tunisia have made their first attack on the Axis-held area of Tripoli in Libya today. They bombed an airfield 10 miles west of the enemy base and scored direct hits. That pays back the British Eighth Army in Libya for some of the attacks it has been making on Axis bases in Tunisia. It also reveals again the cooperation between the Allied forces in the East and West. Both, of course, are working with a common objective: to drive the Axis from all North Africa, and first, to drive them from the air. Allied air power in the last few days also has won and is still winning important decisions in the Pacific. And for a report direct from that area, Admiral Radio takes you now to CBS Honolulu, Webley Edwards reporting.
This is Honolulu. The mopping up on the Papua Peninsula of New Guinea has forced the Jap back some 150 miles to his bases at Lae and Salamaua. This, however, is not so much of a retreat by him as it is a nipping off and destroying of his advanced base by the Allied forces. There were hardly any survivors to retreat. In a broader sense, the Japs have not even started the retreat in the Pacific. They've been stopped, yet even now they're preparing to strike again. The latest reports are that our planes carried out a continuous night and day attack on a Jap convoy in the Huon Gulf area of northeastern New Guinea, hitting two transports, one of which was burning, the other beached, shooting down or destroying on the ground 43 fighter planes, damaging a bomber and six fighters, in addition probably shooting 17 other Jap fighters out of the sky. Also, an additional seven out of 15 Jap fighter planes that attacked our planes on a return flight from bombing a Jap airdrome at Madan. But reinforcements were believed landed by the Japs in the Huon Gulf area. In the Solomons and Guadalcanal, American forces hold their precious ground and its priceless airfield. Land fighting continues, but patrol action. Up north, at the other end of the vast Pacific front, the action is by sea and air, rather by land. The picture out here, then, is one of continuous bombing by air of Jap bases by our forces. Bombing that also extends into the reaches of the sea, seeking out Jap transports carrying reinforcement troops for New Guinea in the south. Despite our sinking of substantial portions of his convoys and the probable death of thousands of Jap troops aboard, The enemy is believed to have been able to strengthen his forces, protecting his airfields in the New Guinea, at Rabaul in New Britain, and the Rakata Bay areas in Santa Isabel of the Solomons. Some of us out here consider the optimistic statement of Admiral William F. Halsey as probably the most un-Halsey-like statement that great fighter ever made. He predicted complete, absolute defeat for the Axis powers, specifically including Japan, in this coming year. That is a large order, even for so great and successful a fighter as Admiral Halsey. If he can justify it, then he has information that many of the rest of us out here would like to have. There's only one reporter speaking, but one who's talked to many men who've been fighting and who've been observing on the long line from the Aleutians to New Guinea. Almost to a man, they predict a long war out here. They resigned to a holding war, with offensive, yes, but still a war of holding until the European deal is closed, and then still a long, hard battle before we give our men liberty in the city of Tokyo. Meanwhile, they're fighting fiercely in a most difficult theater of war with tremendous courage and inspiring success. This is Webley Edwards speaking from Pearl Harbor. We return you to CBS in New York.
And now, before we get more reports from CBS correspondents abroad, here is Warren Sweeney with a word from Admiral Radio.
Wherever America's fighting sons are serving, whether as advance scouts on the desert wastes of Africa or as snipers in the foxholes of the Solomons, one ever-faithful friend is always at their side. That friend is their radio, built by Admiral. America's fighting sons spent many happy hours listening to their Admiral radio in the living room back home. Now they find it's an Admiral-built radio that fights with them on the field of battle. And the meeting of so dependable an old friend out there is a heartwarming experience. Knowing this, knowing the confidence these fighting men have in Admiral, inspires every worker in Admiral's two great plants with a desire to produce the best radio equipment possible as fast as possible. And all they produce goes to help America's armed services attain victory. When victory is won, Admiral will again build fine radios and radio phonograph combinations for home use, and thus serve these fighting sons a third time. For as victors, they will want to take into their own homes the familiar friend of pre-war days, the dependable partner of the battlefield, a radio built by Admiral, the only radio known as America's Smart Set. Now, here again is John Daly.
Now, across the Atlantic for the news of European developments, Admiral Radio turns now to CBS London, Bob Trout reporting.
In London, for some weeks, war correspondents who specialize in reporting air operations have been arguing about the absence of an all-out air offensive against the Germans on the continent during the past 2 months. Some say the comparative lull has been due to Allied operations on other fronts, which required planes that would otherwise have gone to Royal Air Force's Bomber Command on this island. Others insist it's just been the weather. But the lull has been only comparative. Last night's Royal Air Force attack on targets in the German city of Essen was the fifth raid on the Ruhr in 7 nights. 7 bombers are missing from this raid and mine-laying operations. The Air Ministry says good results from the British 4,000-pound bombs were seen at Essen. The weather over the targets was clear last night. While we cannot give weather details in wartime, everyone knows that Britain's weather has little in common with the weather in many American areas where new United States Army pilots are taught to fly. British fogs and rain are as much of a military factor as Tunisia's mud. Today, the London Sunday Express's columnist, Matt Gubbins, says only the British could survive food and fuel rationing and a wet northeast wind. The Huns, he says, might stand 2 winters in Russia, but I doubt if they'd stand 1 in England. Today's German High Command communique was read with some interest in London, where it was noticed that the German communique today speaks of the German garrison at Veliki Luki heroically resisting strong Russian attacks. For days, the Germans have been keeping up the pretense that they still hold Veliki Luki, possibly counting on recapturing this strong point and then claiming that they had never lost it. Perhaps that word heroically in today's communique means the German high command is losing hope of recapturing Veliki Luki. For the last time a German communique spoke of Germans fighting heroically was in making a half-hearted admission of the Russian breakthrough on the Middle Don front. Also in today's German communique, all the fighting on what the German high command yesterday so vaguely described as the Don region and between the Don and the Caucasus is now described as the defense battle in the south. This is said to be going on with unabated violence, all Russian attacks having been repelled. Britain's Home Secretary, Herbert Morrison, today made a speech at Newcastle dealing with the post-war future of the British Commonwealth. "I want it to last," he said, "not because it's British, but because it's good and will be better yet. Without it, the world would lose a great factor of stability and progress just when those things are most needed." Mr. Morrison said, "It's not enough for our friends or critics abroad to pay lip service to the self-governing empire. It's necessary that they understand it. Other people may think there must be a catch in it somewhere. Well, there is no catch. The freedom and independence of the Dominions are real. The proof is ERA, Southern Ireland, which decided to stay out of the war and was left free to do so to the great hurt of the Empire's cause and with little advantage to her reputation." Britain's Home Secretary had something to say about worldwide peace and worldwide security, not just freedom from want and freedom from fear in Britain alone. And he had a good deal to say about the future of the Empire's colonies, those territories which have not yet attained the status of dominions. It's impossible to cover, in this report, the points which Herbert Morrison covered or touched on. I suggest that you read the speech, not because you'll necessarily like it, but as long as this transatlantic controversy is going on, the criticisms might just as well be based on the facts. If there has to be an argument, it always helps a little when both sides talk about the same thing. London has reports from the Middle East of increasingly heavy blows by Allied air forces against the enemy in North Africa, especially in the past 48 hours. The range and number of Royal Air Force night operations have been increased, and Royal Air Force and United States Army Air Force bombers coming from east and west have now met for the first time in a sort of air pincers attack on the German bases in Tripolitania. Next to CBS Cairo and the report of Columbia's correspondent in Cairo.
Mr. Morrison in Cairo. Nothing you would call news is coming through the evil weather that now blankets the front in Libya. But the front that 10 weeks ago was 150 miles from Cairo is now 1,500 miles away, and getting there is proportionately difficult. Let me tell you instead what goes on here. A year ago, an American in this city was almost a rarity. Now even the shoeshine boys have learned to spot American insignia and even to identify an American in civilian clothes. The other night in the lobby of Shepherd's Hotel, I heard the unmistakable accent of Indiana cutting through the murmur of lobby conversation. It was the voice of an American girl in the blue uniform of the Army nurses. "Yes," I heard her say to an English captain, "yes, I know, I'm a pretty girl, but right now I'm hungry, and what are we going to do about that?" I see Americans everywhere now, all of them doing something, all learning the terrible importance of this front. And as I watch them, I think that perhaps the reason the shoeshine boys can spot them is their air of brisk freshness. Listening to my countrymen here is like attending a continuous performance of Gone with the Wind. So many of them are from the South. But today I was talking to a Yankee from Cambridge, Massachusetts. He told me the leaves turned red and yellow last fall, as though nothing were more important. He said there was snow now in the little streets, and that the subway fare to Boston is still a dime. And as we talked, I remembered a Yorkshireman. He told me the leaves turned red and yellow last fall, as though nothing were more important. He said there was snow now in the little streets, and that the subway fare to Boston is still a dime. And as we talked, I remembered a Yorkshireman who told me all one night about his own village of Putsey, and I realized that there must be thousands of conversations like this. People here don't talk about war. War to us has become not a crusade, but a job to be finished. People here talk about home and about tomorrow. They have ideas about the world tomorrow, and if the ideas crystallize and have effect, tomorrow's will be a better world. This is Chester Morrison returning you to CBS New York.
That was Chester Morrison of the Chicago Sun reporting from Cairo. 1,500 miles to the north in Russia, the Red Army is still advancing. But the midday communique from Moscow makes it clear that the Nazis are counterattacking desperately. So far, the counterattacks seem to have done little good, since even the German communique claims only that the Nazi armies are fighting defensively. On the other hand, the Russian noon communique said that the Red Army had occupied 30 inhabited localities in the Caucasus region, and press dispatches indicate that the important Nazi-held railway junction, Georgievsk, is practically surrounded with Russian troops within 10 miles of the city. In the Don area, where the Nazi counterattacks were the heaviest, the Russians claimed new gains and said the Germans suffered a serious defeat and heavy losses of equipment. Thus, at week's beginning, with at least five Red Armies driving directly or indirectly on Rostov, the Russians appear to have a reasonable chance to cut off the Axis armies in the Caucasus. Next, to our own hemisphere for news from Latin America. Admiral Radio takes you now to CBS Chile, Charles Griffin reporting.
The resolution will come, it is expected, toward the end of next week or soon afterwards, when the Senate is informed of the latest developments by means of the exposition, to be read out on Tuesday the 12th by the Foreign Minister. The Minister of Interior, Senor Raúl Morales, delivered a report of his recently completed official mission to the United States last night, and President Rios, accompanied by Foreign Minister Senor Joaquín Fernández and a number of experts, is devoting the weekend in his summer residence at Viña del Mar to give the finishing touches to the proposal for an early break-off with the Axis, it is affirmed. The Foreign Minister denied the report that the presidents of Chile and Argentina contemplated meeting soon on the border.
That was Charles Griffin reporting from Chile. One of Colombia's reporters is today in one of the famous bombers that gave Tokyo the first taste of American bombs. Admiral Radio switches now to a microphone aboard a B-25 somewhere over the Gulf of Mexico, and Bill Slocum, Jr., ready to report from one of America's most efficient fighting weapons.
Jet is purely coincidental, because I am now laying on my stomach in a B-25. A vicious piece of fighting machinery built to carry bombs and more bombs and a minimum of human cargo. This B-25 is the same model that Jimmy Doolittle and some other ambitious young Americans took off from Shangri-La for a little bombing job in and around Tokyo. The B-25 is also the ship that is making clay pigeons out of Axis boats and supply depots in North Africa. It is really quite a ship. And restrictions permitting, I'd like to tell you how this dynamite-spitting gadget works. It's a two-motor job, and it carries, in addition to bombs, heavy and well-distributed machine gun emplacements. Its normal crew consists of six men, but if Shangri-La happens to be some distance away, it can function with fury. At the controls of this B-25 is Lieutenant J.B.'s Richard of Great Neck, Long Island, a schoolmate of mine, and once something of the town's problem child. Today, he's operations officer at Southeast Training Center of the Flying Training Command's Tyndall Field, and a very serious young man indeed. Lieutenant Richard, you've been pointing my ear about B-25s for 2 days now. Would you repeat some of that briefly for the listeners?
The B-25 is a great bombing instrument because it's capable of carrying a heavy load and still move fast enough to keep fighter planes at a respectful distance. Plenty of machine gun protection, too. It's a trifle hot when she lands, but if you tend to your business, you won't have much trouble getting her in.
Thank you, Lieutenant Richard. A little hot is pilot's terminology for a plane that lands with great speed, and the B-25 does that, just as it does everything else, with high speed. The B-25 is a big airplane, although it is called a medium bomber. It permits its crew all the freedom of movement they would have, all six of them in a telephone booth. It is a compact instrument of war, and unless you want to wriggle along in your stomach, you stay put once you get in. Before me are a pilot and a co-pilot. In front of them, down in the nose, is a bombardier. Behind me, sitting on a tiny stool, is a navigator, and next to him, a very grim young man who handles a very potent piece of machine gun gear. There's another gun farther back. There are gadgets everywhere. I can't tell you much about them because, A, I don't know anything about them, and B, I wouldn't be let talk about them if I knew. But I do know American ingenuity has poured steel, aluminum, cloth, and dynamite into a piece of fighting machinery which when mixed with the courage and brains of American airmen should go a long way towards shortening up this war. And Tokyo Air Wardens will be unhappy to learn that we are not faced with any shortage of B-25s at the moment. I return you to CBS in New York and John Daly.
Now, for the news at home, Admiral Radio takes you next to CBS Washington, Lee White reporting.
Washington this week has come to a sort of turning point. Except for the rumpus over Ed Flynn's hopes of becoming a diplomat after resigning as chairman of the Democratic National Committee, there's no immediate cause for bickering between the administration and its opponents. There's the question of post-war planning, of course. In his speech last Wednesday, the president said he thought it within the realm of possibility that the 78th Congress would be called upon to formulate a peace. Yesterday, the dominant isolationist member of the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, Mr. Nye, said he thought the New Deal's peace plans were doomed to failure, just as were those of Wilson. But he added that he and his Republican colleagues would have no objection to discussing peace plans calmly with their Democratic opponents, even while the war is going on. In Congress last Wednesday, I watched the reactions of certain legislators to Mr. Roosevelt's speech. Hamilton Fish and Arthur Vandenberg never once applauded, except when Mr. Roosevelt left the House. But Gerald Nye applauded every time the president mentioned disarmament or peace, except on one occasion when the phrase was durable peace. In general, the president's speech was well received, though the applause I noticed was rather milder from the Republican wing than those who heard the speech over the radio may have thought. Even Republicans, however, accepted the speech as a conciliatory gesture on the part of Mr. Roosevelt. And it was conciliatory, except on one specific point, expansion of Social Security after the war. Here the president, in saying, "I dissent," made it very clear that in the 2 years remaining to the administration, he would do everything in his power to impress on Congress what he considers its obligation to our fighting men, to assure them of the third freedom, freedom from want, by means of permanent unemployment insurance and free hospital and medical care for those who require it. At his White House conference on Friday, the president was asked if he anticipated much debate on Senator Wagner's pending Social Security bill. He said he didn't, and explained that he felt the differences at the moment are based on methods of attaining Social Security rather than the principle that Social Security is a good and necessary thing. Tomorrow, the Congress will receive the president's budget message for the fiscal year beginning on the 1st of next July. Mr. Roosevelt is expected to request appropriations of more than $100 billion, mostly for war expenditures, and Congress is expected to give his text a very critical appraisal. Most of our legislators are dead set against spending a cent more than is necessary, even for airplanes, but our legislators are not expected to quibble over the direct costs of the war. They may argue over some of the president's views, for his budget message is expected to be couched in far more specific, stronger terminology than his address on the state of the nation. But they won't even have much of an opportunity to fight over income taxes, for the president has anticipated their temper and has already gone on record in favor of pay-as-you-go, though he still supports Mr. Morgenthau and others at the Treasury in their opposition to the Rummel plan, so-called. Neither he nor Mr. Morgenthau any longer oppose pay-as-you-go in principle. So it's almost certain that Congress will shortly pass the Rummel plan or something very like it, no matter what it's called, and with a very substantial majority. There will be very little debate in Congress. But one thing people ought to understand is this. Pay-as-you-go isn't going to save anybody any money. It will merely ensure that taxes are paid on time. A Navy communique just released announces two more raids on the Japanese airfield at Munda on New Georgia Island, but apparently with no great results. We now return you to CBS in New York.
Returning for a moment to the air war in Tunisia, back in this country after serving on the North African front, Brigadier General Stuart C. Godfrey of the Aviation Engineers has an interesting story of methods of building advanced air bases almost overnight. Godfrey says when it became necessary to establish advanced bases to support the action in Tunisia, a call was put in for airborne engineers. With their equipment, they were flown in cargo planes to points as close as possible to the selected sites. Within 3 days, flying fortresses were taking off from the first base, and a second base was completed on the next day. And now, Warren Sweeney with a word from Admiral Radio.
As you know, point rationing will soon go into effect. The government is doing much to help you understand how it works, giving you daily information by means of radio programs. All you need do is listen, and of course, keep your radio in good operating order. This last is a job which had better be turned over to your Admiral dealer. It's almost impossible to buy a new radio, and even some parts are difficult to replace these days. So don't let an inexperienced person service a radio you own. Your Admiral dealer can put almost any set in perfect condition quickly and economically because he has the right tools, the facilities, and years of experience. Admiral dealers consider it a patriotic duty to help keep America's radios in tip-top shape, just as Admiral considered it a patriotic duty to turn both great Admiral plants to war production, the same plants which made Admiral in peacetime the world's largest manufacturer of radio phonograph combinations with automatic record changers. So call your Admiral dealer for radio service. Be sure your set is in the hands of an expert. When you buy war bonds and stamps, you're protecting your future in two ways. First, war bonds and stamps ensure the freedoms and liberties American citizens have always enjoyed. Second, you're saving for a rainy day or for the luxuries you'll be able to have after victory is won. For logical reasons, invest 10% of your earnings in U.S. war bonds and stamps. Don't let yourself or Uncle Sam down. World News Today is brought to you each Sunday at this hour by Continental Radio and Television Corporation, makers of Admiral Radio, America's smart set. Be sure to listen again next Sunday when Admiral brings you World News Today by shortwave, direct from the leading news centers of the world. This is Warren Sweeney speaking for Admiral Radio. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Our next news broadcast will be heard at 4:45 this afternoon. This is the WBBM Air Theater, Wrigley Building, Chicago.
Ladies, lend an ear to me, ladies. Listen here to me, better complexions in just 2 weeks. Palm Olive brings you proof that speaks.
Here's all you do. Wash your face with Palm Olive soap 3 times a day. Then each time, take 1 minute more to massage Palm Olive's remarkable beautifying lather into your skin. Then rinse. That's all. 36 leading doctors prove 2 out of 3 women get better complexions with this new method in just 14 days. Get Palm Olive because
there may be new beauty for you as soon as you do.
So start today the Palm Olive way.
Every day, brush your teeth the Colgate way.
Yes, sir, when you hear that jingle, you know the makers of Colgate Tooth Powder present Al Jolson, his guest Robert Benchley, and Carol Bruce, Park Yukonkis, and Ray Block and his orchestra. And here's Al.
You'll hear me calling you 'neath your window some sweet day. You'll hear me calling you, then you'll know I'm home to stay. When I hear your cheery answer, it will make my dreams come true. Because I know that you means I love you. I love the girl I left behind me. I know she waits for my return. Soon in her arms you're gonna find me. Oh, how I'll hold her. I've wrote and told her. Hear me calling you. She's your window some sweet day. You will hear me calling you, then you'll know I'm home to stay. When I hear your cheery answer, it will make my dreams come true. Because I know that you means I love you.
Thank you.
you, folks. Thank you, thank you. Oh, you're swell tonight. Well, sir, I certainly had a tough time getting here tonight. Right here, this broadcast. I didn't think I'd be here. You know, Fred, I put my car away, and honestly, in New York, you cannot get a taxicab for love nor money. It certainly took the gas rationing board to put the country back on its feet. Really, it did. You know something? Oh, no, it isn't that good. Well, anyway. Oh, this will kill you. Look, I couldn't even hire a horse. There's not a horse to be had. I tried 5 butcher shops. Honestly, I did.
Well, the government ban on pleasure driving sure has affected everybody, Al.
Everybody but the Russians. They're driving towards Rostov, and believe me, it's a pleasure. And you know something, Freddy? I heard, I don't know how true it is, I hope it is true, that the snow is so deep in Russia, Hitler has to jack up his generals to shoot him. Really, I think so.
Well, I understand you put your car in storage, Al. You know, the police are certainly enforcing that new ruling.
New ruling? You said it, Fred. Get this. A cop stopped a car on Fifth Avenue the other day and said to the man at the wheel, "Hey, haven't you heard about the ban on pleasure driving?" And the fellow said, "What pleasure driving? This is my mother-in-law alongside of me."
Well, say, Al, I suppose you had to fire your chauffeur.
No, I didn't fire my chauffeur. I still have my chauffeur. He's just got a little easier, that's all. You know what he does now? He carries me piggyback to the subway, puts a nickel in the slot, and it's through for the day.
Well, I guess everybody will have to give up the car soon.
Everybody except my uncle Gremlin Jolson. He doesn't need much gas for his car.
Doesn't the rubber shortage bother him either?
Nah. Instead of tires, my uncle uses 4 manhole covers dipped in bubble gum.
Hello, Al.
Well, Carol Bruce, shut my mouth.
Say, Al, I heard you gave your car up.
Yes, and I was glad to do it. But there's little things I miss. Now, for instance, I won't be able to go to Lake Placid for the winter sports. And you know how crazy I am about skiing, Carol.
Oh, you mean sheeing, Al.
What?
You mean sheeing.
Sheeing, I like that too. Well, anyway, I'll never forget the first time I went skiing. I'll never forget it. As I came down the ski slide and went gliding through the air, I felt like a goose on the loose. Really, I did. Then I landed... Lady, will you cut that out, please? The second week you've done that. Then I've got to go over it again. Well, sir, I felt like a goose on the loose. Then I landed head first in a snowbank, and I felt like a drip with a pip. That's the place to land. And now Carl Bruce will sing the big song of the day, Brazil.
Brazil, the Brazil that we knew, where I wandered with you, lives in my imagination. Where the songs are passionate, and a smile has flash in it, and a kiss has art in it, for you put your heart in it. And so I dream of old Brazil, where hearts were entertaining June. We stood beneath an amber moon and softly murmured, "Someday soon." We kissed and clung together. Then tomorrow was another day. I will to old Brazil.
Thank you very much, Carol Bruce. That was lovely indeed. So you know, folks, when your one and only love in life starts going out with somebody else, it's kind of too late to start worrying about whether or not your breath is always sweet. Now, that's something you've got to be sure about in advance. And that's why it's important to know now that in 7 cases out of 10, Colgate tooth powder stops all unpleasing breath. Yes, stops it instantly. And that's a scientific fact. And it means now you can be sure of having a breath that's sweet and wholesome. Friends, it's so easy to protect yourself the Colgate tooth powder way. You simply brush your teeth night and morning and before every date with Colgate tooth powder. Feel how it bursts instantly into a lively, active, penetrating foam that swirls busily into those hard-to-get-at places, leaves your mouth feeling cool, clean, and gloriously refreshed. And at the same time, the soft, safe polishing material in Colgate tooth powder reveals all the natural, attractive brilliance of your teeth. And that's why I say, for a breath that's sweet and a smile that dazzles, get Colgate tooth powder, won't you please? It's the tooth powder that cleans your breath as it cleans your teeth.
Tonight, ladies and gentlemen, our guest is a man who's made laughter his business. He's done more to tickle the risibilities of a nation than any man I know. You've seen him in pictures, you've heard him on the radio, and you've read his books. Colgate is proud to present Bob Benchley. Well, Bob, now you're on your mettle. Everybody knows, everybody listening in knows that you're a humorist. Well, how about starting off with something funny? Go on, let's hear you pull a few nifties. Come on.
No, no, Al. With prices the way they are, you better lay your own eggs.
Monty Woolley without a beard. Well, anyway. Well, if you want to be funny, I know a joke about a chicken, but I won't pull it.
You see, that's what I mean, Al. You know, there's also a ceiling on corn.
In that case, look, I didn't mean to be funny. Let's drop the whole thing. Let's talk about your visit to New York, Bob. Tell me something, old boy. How are you enjoying it here?
Well, it's a little too cold for me, Al.
Yeah?
In fact, I woke up this morning drooling icicles.
Drooling icicles? Well, you see, you've been in California for a few years, and maybe your blood probably is a little thin.
Well, I'm glad of that. I hate fat blood.
Hate fat? Well, I don't mind that. But anyway, if you think it's cold, listen, you should have been here last week. It was so cold. The girls in the Star and Garter Review next door had to put on their red flannel beads. That's cold. And you know, get this, and you know that picture in my bedroom of Whistler's mother sitting in a rocker?
Yeah.
Well, last night she had her feet in a pan of hot water. Really, that's cold.
Well, Al, all I know is I almost froze over at the shipyards this morning.
Yeah?
I started to launch a ship, and something happened to my arm.
Well, what was it, Bob? Frostbite or something?
I don't know what it was, Al. I just couldn't get the bottle past my mouth. Boy, I wound up with a nasty headache. It's terrible.
From the champagne?
I don't know what it was, Al. I just couldn't. They ran out of champagne, so they had to launch the ship with me.
Oh, I get it. For a moment, I didn't see anybody.
No, I didn't think anybody. That was a break, wasn't it?
Yeah. Well, Bob, listen. I know you haven't been to New York for quite a while. I'd like to show you around. Tell me something. Where are you staying?
At the YWCA.
Maybe you better show me around. It might surprise you, though, Bob, to know this. I'm an air warden at the Martha Washington Hotel.
Really?
Yeah, and every day I go down and see my sirens.
Well, I've been seeing a little bit of New York myself.
Yeah?
I went to a little nightclub last night, and they had a balloon dancer there.
A balloon dancer? Did you have a good time?
Oh, swell. Till the manager took away my bean shooter.
I'm surprised at you, Bob, pulling a bean shooter on a balloon dancer. What would Miss Tuttlesnapper, your old school teacher, say?
Well, she was a balloon dancer.
Oh. Well, Bob, I couldn't take you to places like that. My uncle would object. You see, he's a member of the Uplift Society.
Uplift Society?
Yeah, he goes around tilting pinball machines. Now there's a subject. It might sound like I'm kidding, but there's a subject you could really do a short on. How to be a successful pinball tilter, or when the lights go on again all over the machine. You know that new thing. You know, Bob, I've seen every one of your shorts. I wouldn't miss them. How to sleep, how to dress, how to eat. What's the next one about?
How to get a pound of coffee.
Now you're talking, brother. How do you get a pound of coffee?
Well, I'm sorry, Al. I can't tell you. That's a civilian secret.
Well, when it comes to getting coffee, I work as hard as LaGuardia does.
What do you mean, Al?
Every day it's the same old grind.
Oh, well.
That's using the old bean. Yeah, that's using.
another one like that, and Sanborn will be chasing you.
What was that? Wait a minute.
That was another one like that, and Sanborn will be chasing you.
Chasing Sanborn.
Thanks, Cameron. Chasing. Kill.
Okay, all right.
What do I have to do?
No, I... Catch it the head and what it is. Okay, I'll stop. Tell me something, Bob. Are you making new shorts?
Yes, Al. We're working on one now called How to Get Rid of Crumbs After Eating Crackers in Bed.
Well, how do you get rid of them?
Well, that's quite a problem, Al. No matter how much you brush them, you'll always find a crumb turning up in the strangest places.
Hello, kids. Park your crackers. Pardon?
Yeah.
I want you to meet a famous movie actor, a man who is known to the girls in Hollywood as a strong, silent type.
Yeah?
A sort of a Super Cooper.
Super Cooper, huh? To me, he looks more like a puny muni.
You don't understand, Parker. This is Robert Benchley.
Oh.
Humorist, author, actor, raconteur, a man about town, and a connoisseur of the arts.
Does he also do his own laundry? Say, you know, you're kept pretty busy, ain't you, Mr. Punchy?
Correction, Parky. My name is Benchley, not Punchy.
I see.
It's always been Benchley. Where'd you get Punchy?
I was wrapped in my head when I was a baby. That's how I happened to go into show business.
Parker, you've been on the stage all these years?
Sure.
Did you really start out as an actor?
No, as a little boy.
What? Naturally. Most of us do.
Not my little sister. You see, I began my career in a play which I wrote myself called Flotsam and Jetsam.
Flotsam and Jetsam?
Yeah.
Well, that's the stuff that lies around the beaches.
That was me for 8 years.
Parker, wait a minute. Lying around the beach is no good for you. That's how you put on all that weight.
No, it's not be my fault when I'm fat, you know. Yeah. I used to have a sickness called 60 miles from Rochester.
Just a moment. A sickness called 60 miles from Rochester?
Yeah, Syracuse veins.
What you need, Parky, is exercise.
Really?
That's what I do. Look at me. I'm as fit as a fiddle.
Yes, and you could use a few new strings, too.
Parky, that's no way to talk to anybody who's trying to help you. You'd be a lot better off if you exercised.
I would?
Yeah, that's what I do, too. Now, every day I take long walks along the waterfront.
Is that good?
Is that good?
Good, it's perfect. Why, the waterfront is wonderful this time of year. What's more beautiful than the East River with snow or the Hudson River with ice?
Green River with ginger ale.
Well, we could use it. I hope you don't mind, Parky, Bob. You see, he doesn't really know what he's saying.
Who don't? I'm not as ignorant as I look, you know.
No?
For your information, last week I made $50 on information, please.
How?
Stole the cash register.
What?
Well, I think Parky's rather amusing, you know?
Yeah, in a gruesome way. Yeah.
Make an ideal companion.
Mm-hmm.
Parky, look, I'm taking a hunting trip next week.
Yeah?
How'd you like to come along and shoot a buck?
You're faded.
Wait a minute. We did that a month ago. Listen.
I was referring to wild game, Parky.
Yeah?
Now, for instance, in my trophy room at home, I have a mounted moose, stuffed eagle, and a mounted elk.
Did you ever bag a mason?
Well, don't be silly, Parky. You couldn't have a mounted mason in your trophy room.
Why not? My cook has got a mounted policeman in the kitchen.
Don't mind this guy, Bob. He's nothing but a big D-O-P-E.
You're right, Al. He's also a J-E-R-K, huh?
Listen, Benchley, I may be a D-O-P-E and a J-E-R-K, but on this program, I'm not just a guest. I got a steady J-O-B.
Well, Bob, now tell me, what is your final opinion of Parky?
Well, I must invite him over to the house.
Yeah?
I want him to frighten my sister. She has hiccups.
Well, hey, Bob, by the way, I heard a lot about your new house. Can I come up to see it sometime?
Anytime you say, Al. But remember, when you reach my house, be sure to go through the iron gate, not the wooden one.
The iron gate?
Yeah, that's a little whim of mine. I don't... You see, the iron gate is for friends, and the wooden gate is for strangers.
And what does your family use what gate?
Colgate, naturally.
This is the play.
Thanks for the game.
Thanks very much for the plug, Bob Benchley. You know, friends, seriously, no matter how attractive a person may look, they're not attractive to be with unless their breath is sweet. Isn't that right? That's why it's important for all of us to know that in 7 cases out of 10, Colgate tooth powder stops oral unpleasing breath instantly. And that's a scientific fact, friends. Scientific proof that you can make sure of having a breath that's sweet, simply by brushing your teeth the easy Colgate tooth powder way. That's all there is to it. Just brush your teeth night and morning and before every date and feel how Colgate tooth powder bursts into a lively, active, penetrating foam. Feel it swirl busily into those hard-to-get-at places, leaving your whole mouth feeling refreshed and cool and clean. Yes, and notice, too, how the soft, safe polishing material in Colgate tooth powder reveals all the natural, attractive sparkle of your teeth. Then you'll know why I say for a breath that's sweet and a smile that dazzles, get Colgate tooth powder, the tooth powder that cleans your breath as it cleans your teeth. And one more thing, friends. These, you know, of course, are war times. So if your dealer happens to be temporarily out of Colgate tooth powder, just remember that the Colgate people are working night and day to keep him supplied, and his order will be filled just as soon as possible.
Use tooth powder every day. Brush your teeth the Colgate way.
This is Bob Benchley again, ladies and gentlemen. In my time, I've seen quite a few pictures. Most of them I've forgotten, but there's one that I'll always remember. That was the picture in which Al Jolson sang a song that will always live in the hearts of young and old alike. And when Mr. Jolson asked me to appear on this program tonight, I made him promise me that he'd sing that song. I'm sure you've all guessed the title by now, Sonny Boy.
Thank you, Bob, for that swell introduction about that little song, and I hope when you're leaving tomorrow for California to make that picture with Fred Astaire, I hope and trust it'll be a big hit.
Climb up on my knee, sonny boy. Though you're only three, sonny boy, you've no way of knowing, there's no way of showing what you mean to me, sonny boy. When there are gray skies, I don't mind the gray sky. You make them blue, sunny boy. Friends may forsake me, let them all forsake me. I still have you, sunny boy. You're sent from a heaven, and I know your worth. You've made a heaven for me right here on earth. When I'm old and gray, dear, promise you won't stray, dear. For I love you so, sonny boy.
When there are gray skies, I don't mind. I don't mind gray skies. You make them blue, sonny boy. Friends may forsake me. Let them all forsake me.
I still have you, sonny boy.
You're sent from heaven, and I know your worth. You've made a heaven for me.
Dear Lord,
and the angels, they grew lonely, took you because they were lonely.
I'm a lonely fool.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Next week, folks, in addition to our regular cast, we bring you one of America's unsung heroes, a boy who just returned from Guadalcanal, Private First Class Dana Babcock, a parachutist in the United States Marine Corps. Private Babcock was in the first boat to storm the beach at Gavutu in the Solomons. And next Tuesday, we bring you Private Babcock and 20 of his Marine buddies. I hope you'll all be listening next Tuesday. Now, good night to you all, and thank you.
Don't forget, friends, it's a date next week with Al Jolson as guest, Private Dana Babcock, and our regular cast presented by Colgate Tooth Powder, the tooth powder that cleans your breath as it cleans your teeth. This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
Don't touch that dial. We still have another hour of old-time radio to come after this short message. If you love the World War II era, consider following us on Patreon. You not only support this channel, but you will get daily posts of pop culture and a daily newspaper in chronological order. It's neat to follow the war as your parents, grandparents, or even your great-grandparents have followed it. Check us out with a one-week free trial. A link is in the comments to this video. For those of you who come to this channel for the classic movies, we are no longer putting them up on this platform on YouTube. We are putting them up on our Patreon page only. That platform is not as strict as YouTube, which means that I can share movies that YouTube blocks. There are a ton of them in our collection, Patreon calls playlists, collections, called Classic Movies from World War II. Take out a free trial and check it out. Browse around there, and I'm sure that you will love what you see. In our next show, we will be spotlighting the week ending January 23rd, 1943. We are going to feature World News Today, of course, Fibber, McGee, and Molly, the Kraft Music Hall with Bing Crosby, and a program that you'll find interesting called Hello Mom. It has a lot of wartime flavor. You'll love that show. I hope that you can come back and visit. My name is Henry Chopp. Now it's time for hour number two. We are going to start with an Edgar Allan Poe story on suspense. The story is The Pit and the Pendulum from January 12, 1943. Following that, we are going to switch our old tube radio over to shortwave and the Armed Forces Radio Service variety program, Command Performance. The stars on this episode are Jeanette MacDonald, Virginia O'Brien, Dale Evans, Eddie South and his orchestra, the Mills Brothers, and Eddie LeBaron and his orchestra. The broadcast is from January 16th, 1943. Well, let's turn back on this old tube radio that's our time machine and give this stuff a listen.
This is your narrator, the man in black, again about to introduce tonight's Columbia program, Suspense. The story is The Pit and the Pendulum by Edgar Allan Poe, the adaptation by John Dixon Carr. Our guest is the distinguished American actor, Mr. Henry Hull, who plays the part of a prisoner of the Spanish Inquisition. If you've been with us on these Tuesday nights, you will know that suspense is compounded of mystery, suspicion, and dangerous adventure. To hold you in a precarious situation and withhold the solution until the last possible moment. And so it is with The Pit and the Pendulum and Mr. Hull's performance. We again hope to keep you in suspense. And now, the pit and the pendulum. I was sick. Sick unto death with that long agony. And when at length they unbound me and I was permitted to sit, I felt that my senses were leaving me. The sound of the inquisitorial voices seemed merged in one dreamy, indeterminate hum. Yet, for a while, I saw, but without terrible an exaggeration, I saw the soft and nearly imperceptible waving of the sable draperies on the walls of the room. I saw the flames of the 7 tall candles which burned on the table. I saw the lips of the black hooded judges, and these lips appeared to me white, white as paper, white as horror. I saw them writhe with a deadly locution. I saw them fashion the syllables of my name.
Jean Delbray. Captain Jean Delbray.
Good father, gentlemen.
We hear you, my son.
I am very weak and infirm. I've been confined for many months in a dungeon. I've been tormented by nightmares.
Conscience, one trusts.
Pray silence, Fra Antonio. Even now, I have no knowledge of where I am or to whom I may be speaking.
You're speaking to me, my son. I am Fra Pedro de Estella, prior of the Dominicans of Segovia and Grand Inquisitor of all Spain.
Is this the cause of the Inquisition?
It is.
Oh, then God help me.
He will help you, my son, if you trust him.
But I am a French officer.
That is true. A soldier and creature of the Archfiend Napoleon Bonaparte.
But a French officer nonetheless. A prisoner of war. By what right do you try me in this court?
Let the clerk read the charges against this prisoner. Pray silence while the clerk reads the charges.
The charges against the prisoner are as follows. In primis, that he is one Jean d'Albret, a captain of artillery in the army of Bonaparte, so-called emperor of the French.
This means nothing, as the prisoner says. It is no crime. Proceed.
Item, that on the 4th day of September in the year of our Lord, 1808, the said Jean d'Albret did wed, espouse, and marry the most noble lady, the Doña Beatriz Valdez, niece of and ward of the
illustrious. One moment.
Your Excellency spoke.
Antonio, was any cheat employed to trap this girl into marriage against her will?
No, we have no actual evidence of any cheat.
Was the girl of age?
I believe so.
Then whoever is the prisoner here? This marriage was a deplorable thing, if you like. Bonaparte himself is almost at the gates of Madrid. His general, Lasalle, menaces our city of Toledo itself. But lawful marriage, however regrettable, is no sin or crime.
There are other matters in the indictment, I think.
Then continue, but give us nothing that is not material.
Item, that on the 12th of October, 1808, the said Jean d'Albret, being in command of a 5-gun battery of light artillery, did direct the fire of his guns against the Holy Church of St. Martha the Innocent.
What?
And thereby of his wicked malice destroyed that church utterly.
Captain d'Albret, is this charge true?
It is, yes.
You admit it?
Good father, hear what I have to say. The church blew up, I think.
Will you boast of your opinion, young man?
It blew up because it was stored with kegs of gunpowder for your army. I had every right to file on it.
And that is all the defense you have to make?
I tell you, I had every right to file on it by military law.
Military law above God's law?
I don't know. I did my duty, that's all.
Long live the Emperor!
Captain d'Albret, mark what I say. No man, however great his heresy, is ever condemned to be burnt in the fire.
Fire?
In the fire. If he first recant and acknowledge the heresy, no pity, no atonement. The only sentence of this court can be death.
Death.
Yes. The secular, a government arm to which we must release you, has devised 2 ways of punishment in cases such as yours. You hear the tolling of the bell?
I hear them.
It is the possession of the condemned going to the auto da fe.
soon the yellow light of the flames will stream through the windows and flicker on floor and ceiling.
Nunc et in hora mortis intuis manibus homine. Most of those condemned out of mercy will be strangled before they are burned. It cannot be so with you, Jean Delbray. You must die in one of two ways. Either with the direst of physical agony.
A slow fire of green wood. Ice bandages about the head and the heart, so that the fire does not approach too quickly.
Or else, Jean Delbray, you must die in a certain other way.
Gentlemen, pass your sentence and let me go.
The law does not permit me to tell you now what this other way is. The sentence of this court, therefore,
I had swooned. Yet still, I will not say that all of consciousness was lost. In the deepest slumber, no. In delirium, no. In a swoon, no. In death, no. Even in the grave, all is not lost. There are shadows of memory which tell us indistinctly of tall figures that lifted me and bore me in silence down, down, still down, until a hideous dizziness oppressed me at the descent into the earth. Then, as consciousness swam back to my wits, darkness, a stone floor, and darkness.
Oh, Beatrice. Beatrice, my wife, Beatrice.
Did you call me, John?
Beatrice. Was that you who spoke?
Yes, Sean.
You were here in the dungeons of the Inquisition.
I am not really speaking to you, my poor Jean. I am only in your imagination.
Am I mad, then?
No. But your brain is fevered. You only think you hear me.
No. I do. I hear you clearly. As clearly as I once heard you.
In the little church near the Ebro where we were married.
Yes. I destroyed that church, Beatrice. I had to. It was my commanding officer's order.
I know, Jean. Be comforted. There are those who care.
You won't leave me.
As long as I am in your heart, I shall be here.
I was strong once. Now I am weak. Once I was reckless. Now I am afraid. Where am I, Beatrice? What are you going to do to me?
I cannot tell. Remember, my voice comes only from your own brain. Are you fettered?
Fettered? No.
They've not chained you to the wall.
No. They've taken away my uniform. They've given me sandals and a robe of what feels like coarse serge. But I'm still free. Free.
Take courage, John.
Free. And in the grasp of the Inquisition. Beatrice.
Yes, Sean.
It's completely dark. There's hardly any air. I dread to get up. I dread to stretch out my hand. Suppose they've buried me alive.
Courage. Can you stand up?
I think so, yes.
Then walk. Walk as far as you can. Measure the limit of the cell. If this is not a tomb...
You're right, Beatrice, as always. I'll find...
Are you on your feet?
Yes, now. Now pray. Pray for a poor devil who always meant well. One pace. Two pace. Three. Four.
You are very weak, John. Rest a moment.
Where are you now, Beatrice? In the flesh, I mean.
You know that, John. In the old house by the olive grove. Gorand of my people.
Yes, I know it.
Each morning I climb to the hilltop and watch.
Go on.
Sometimes I think I hear guns rumble in the hills.
Yes.
And long moving columns with the red dust rising above.
Go on.
First come the heavy cavalry in plume crested helmets.
Yes.
On their flanks wheeling like hawks, light hussars in blue and scarlet. And behind them, in a glitter of bayonets as vast as light points on the sea, rank upon rank. The long gray coats and the tall bearskin caps.
The old guard and the grand army.
It is only a vision, my dear one. They do not come.
Will they ever come, Beatrice?
I cannot tell.
Then I must face what has been prepared for me.
Walk again, Jean. Try. keep your hand in front of you.
This rope, it impedes me, and the floor is treacherous and slimy. But I'll try. Four paces. Five. Six. Seven.
It can't be a tomb.
Eight. Nine.
Look out!
I'm all right. I fell to my knees. The rope tripped me. My hand is in front of me. It's lower than my face, but I feel nothing.
Nothing, Jean.
It's a pit. A circular pit. And I fell on the very edge of it.
Oh. They would have made you walk into it.
Yeah. Oh, there's a loose fragment of rock just inside the edge. If I can dislodge it.
Rats, it may be.
Rats, yes, but something else. I heard it move.
So did I. What is in the pit, Sean?
I don't know.
But you're saved.
Saved, Beatrice. Saved from the Inquisition. My torture has been merely postponed. Deep sleep fell upon me. Sleep like that of death. How long it lasted, I know not. But when I opened my eyes once again, I could see. Yes, see. My prison was large and lofty. Its walls formed a massive iron plate, bolted or joined together. A wild, sulphurous luster, I could not trace its origin, lit up the dungeon, and the circular pit, and the crudely daubed skeleton figures painted in evil colors on the iron walls. Skeleton figures, demon figures, gargoyle figures. The colors a little blurred, as from the effects of a damp.
It must approach you slowly and force itself into your mind.
It must stalk you like a tiger.
It must bring you face to face at last with the king of terror.
When I regained consciousness, I lay on my back in full length on a low framework of wood. To this framework, I was securely bound by a long fastening resembling a surgical bandage. Bound? But why?
Why? Why?
The bandage passed round and round my body, leaving at liberty only my head and my left arm. With much exertion, I could supply myself with food from an earthen dish on the floor beside me. It was meat, highly seasoned, but there was no water.
Beatrice, where are you?
Here, John, as always.
Your voice sounds stronger.
Does it, John?
And I can see you now. I can see you as clearly as I saw you months ago.
Oh, I wish it were true.
Your bonnet and the parasol you carried in summer and the high-waisted blue dress.
You are weaker, my dear, and more fevered.
Have I been asleep?
Yes, John.
They must have been here while I slept. They have bound me. Why?
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 Stop those voices! Why? Stop them!
Mine
why?
Too, Jean.
Why?
I am not here either, you
why?
Know. Don't drive me away.
Beatrice, look.
Where?
At the ceiling of this room. 30, 40 feet up, what do you see?
I see painted on the ceiling the figure of Father Time.
Anything else?
But Father Time carries no sign.
No.
He carries instead what looks like a gigantic pendulum from an ancient clock.
About one thing I swear I'm in my right senses. I saw that pendulum move.
A painting cannot move.
Yet I swear the pendulum did move. It swung a little back and forth, just like a real pendulum.
Try not to trouble your brain.
That pendulum is real. Beatrice, take care.
Take care of what? You're not looking at the pendulum now.
Take care of the rats in the pit.
I see them.
They're spawning out in dozens. You can see their eyes glitter. One of them ran across the hem of your dress.
They did, son.
What do they want?
They've caught the scent of the meat in the dish beside
you. But they'll not get it. Go away, you famine!
Move your hand above the plate, John. Move!
Beatrice, where are you going? I can hardly hear you.
You are sending me away, John.
I am sending you away.
My poor loved one. You can't bear to see the rats running about my feet.
Beatrice!
Yes, it's true. There are cells swarming with vermin. There are others I'd rather see here. I'd rather see...
You call me Captain Dalbray. Then in spirit, I am here.
Who are you?
Don't you recognize me?
No, I do not.
I am that second inquisitor, Fra Antonio, whom you thought unfair at your trial. But we were not unfair. We administer the law. That is all.
Go. I command you, go.
Not until I have first told you what you already guessed.
Which is?
There are two forms of death for such as you. One, death with its direst physical torture. The other, death with its direst mental torture.
And I have been condemned to the second?
Your guess is good. Listen. Do you hear anything?
Yes, I do. I hear something.
Turn your eyes upwards. Look at the ceiling.
Pendulum.
Aye, the pendulum.
It's descended.
Only a foot or so, as yet. As you notice, it is not really a pendulum. Its underside is a crescent, formed of sharp, of razor-sharp steel.
You mean?
A ponderous weight, Captain Dalbray. Its movement is slow now, but soon it will take on momentum. It will swing wider and wider, 30 feet, perhaps. Presently, as it swings, you will hear it hiss. And with each broad movement, it will creep a trifle lower.
Steel is directly above me.
Yes. Well, the region of your heart. Lie still and look up at it.
How long before?
You need have no immediate fear. It will not be too soon.
But how soon?
Who can tell?
In the name of pity, give me some answer.
Hours, perhaps days.
It's beginning to swing wider. I can't take my eyes from it.
Its glitter fascinates me. Eh? See how it shines in that wild light.
And this is your utmost refinement in cruelty.
The law, Captain Dalbray, is never cruel. And now... still in spirit, I leave you to your meditations. It will not be too soon. Minutes, hours, days.
Down. Steadily down it crept. Days passed. It might have been many days before it swept so closely as to fan me with its morbid breath. Minutes. Hours. Days. The odor of the sharp steel forced itself into my nostrils. The right. The left. Far and wide. The shriek of a damned spirit. My heart with a stealthy pace of a tiger. Down. Certainly, relentlessly down.
I prayed. I wearied heaven with my prayer for its more speedy descent. I grew frantically mad and struggled to force myself up against that swinging, glittering death. No avail. Down. Still unceasingly, still inevitably down the sharp steel path within 3 inches of my chest. Beatrice! Beatrice!
John! John. I am here.
It is a strange thing, Gladys. I'm quite calm.
You are resigned, then.
No. That is a strange thing. Even now, I am not resigned.
Is there a way out?
How can there be? 10, 12 more vibrations, and will fray the surge of my robe. Only lightly as a reaper in a delicate hand. There will be many sweets before it bites deep. No, I can't escape it.
You kept me away from you, Jean. You locked me out of your thoughts. If I am here only in your thoughts, why should I fear the rats?
Rats!
You open your eyes and your eyes blaze. What is it?
Rats! Do they still swarm here?
Across the floor and over the meat platter. They have taken nearly all your food.
Yes, of course, they are ravenous, and they have sharp teeth.
Well?
The meat is oily and spiced. If I pick what remains of it, scatter, you vermin! And rub that meat on the bandages that hold me here.
Why, John, try.
Maybe too late, if I leave my body a fraction of an inch up.
Try it, I tell you, try.
Ah, but look, this. Sir, as soon as I do try.
But they are watching you. I can see their eyes. Look. They're creeping back.
Can I find the rats crawling across me? Can the flesh bear it?
One of them has leaped on the wooden framework. Another follows. They're gnawing at the bandage.
7, 8 more sweeps of the pendulum.
The bandage, give way.
A little.
Light still, John, light still.
10, 12, a dozen rats now. Is death, I wonder, worse than this disgust?
A dozen sharp knives could do no better. The bandage is loosened to ribbons. Now, if you move sideways,
yes,
carefully,
yes,
and drop to the floor.
Stop it, I can't move. My arms and my legs are numb. There is no power
the
to...
The steel has frayed your robe. A minute more will be too late.
Then, with all the strength that is in me, and all the hate that I bear my enemies...
Free! The second time.
Free!
Bijan, the pendulum stops. They are drawing it back up through the roof.
Each move I make, they watched. You never doubted that?
No. Yet with all they could do to you, they have failed twice.
They will not fail a third time, my dear. There must be no more dallying with a king of terrors.
What else can they do?
I can't say. See how the rats gnaw in silence at that bandage. To what food, I wonder, have they been accustomed in the pit?
But you escaped the pit.
I escaped it once. Listen.
What do you hear?
A groaning. It's a grinding as of metal.
It was only the cog wheels of the pendulum.
I think not, Beatrice.
Why not?
It seemed to come from behind those iron-plated walls. It seems to shake the dungeon as a mill wheel might shake it.
Stand up, my poor Jean. Get up off your knees.
I can't, Beatrice. I can't endure anymore.
The paintings on the walls of this dungeon, the skeletons and imps and devils, they seem different.
They are different. The colors sharpen and grow bright. The demon's eyes glare. The skeleton hands are stretched. Don't you catch even yet the odor of heated iron?
Heated iron?
Beatrice, my darling, I have been much humbled. But I won't have you see me in tears. I order you to go.
John, in the name of heaven.
Beatrice.
You're sending me away.
Yes, yes, go. In the name of heaven. Go, go. A suffocating heat pervaded the prison. A deeper glow settled in the painted eyes that glared at me. I could draw no breath of air into my lungs. Against the loom of that fiery destruction, the thought of the pit and its coolness come like a soothing balm. I staggered to the edge of the pit. I looked into it. The enkindled walls and roof lighted it to its depths. Yet for one wild moment, even then, I refused to believe the horror of what I saw beneath me.
Does the pit please you, Captain Dalbrey?
Does the pit, merciful God, anything but that?
And how shall you avoid it? Look.
This dungeon has changed its shape.
That is true. The walls are closing in. It was formerly a square. Now it is flattening
slowly toward the center to force me into the pit.
Of course.
It'll force you along with me.
Again, apparently you must be told, Captain Dalbrey, that you are speaking only to your own sick fancy.
I am not here at all. Farewell.
Now closer and closer through the red burning walls, forcing me into the pit with a swiftness that left me no time for thought. I shrank back, but the closing walls pressed me relentlessly onward. At length, for my seared and writhing body, there was no longer an inch of foothold. I started on the edge of the pit. Back, an outstretched arm caught my own, and I was about to fall, fainting into the abyss. It was that of General LaSalle. The French army had entered Toledo. The Inquisition was in the hands of its enemies.
And so closes Poe's celebrated story, The Pit and the Pendulum, starring Henry Hull. We invite you to another adventure of suspense next Tuesday at the same hour. Until then, this is the Man in Black saying good night.
William Spear, the producer, John Dietz, the director, Bernard Herrmann, the composer-conductor, and John Dixon Carr, the author, are collaborators on
Suspense.
This is the Columbia Broadcasting System.
USA, the greatest entertainers in America, is requested by you, the fighting men of the United States Armed Forces throughout the world. Command Performance, presented this week and every week till it's over there. Okay there, men, it's Command Performance time, so come and get it from the USA. And that goes for every son and daughter of Uncle Sam around the globe, and for all of you in all the United Nations who are lined up beside the men who are lined up against the Axis. Again tonight, your big show, presented by the Special Service Division of the War Department, is playing to a full house of servicemen and holding a royal flush in music. And don't ever forget it, those swell letters you write in are the aces in our deck. And dealing right off the top, here's the lovely star whose trumps in the hearts of thousands of you. By worldwide command of the AEF, your mistress of ceremonies, Jeanette MacDonald.
Thank you, Ken Carpenter. From Stalingrad to Auckland, and from North Island to North Africa, to points west of the Golden Gate and east of Our Lady out there in New York Harbor, to the north and to the south of the equator, it's love from the USA to the AEF. In your history books, Command Performance was always for the King and Queen. Well, it's still that way, only the King of Command Performance USA is crowned with an overseas helmet and wears the royal blue and khaki of Uncle Sam. And the Queen's in the uniform of the Army and Navy nurse. And Hollywood is the royal court of entertainment that's yours to command. Our first command tonight comes from a stately palace known as Hut 403 on Island X, somewhere in the Pacific. And bears the great seal of Slick, George, Three Striper, Cricket, Woodsy, and Big Gun. And we hear echoes of the same request from APO 27 and Milton Ford and from Carol James at APO 812. One of the big hit tunes here at home, sung by a girl who's a hit from coast to coast. Why don't you fall in love with me? with the Command Performance Orchestra and Dale Evans. As long as you're not in love with anyone else, why don't you fall in love with me? You're driving me crazy, baby, trying to guess. Will you tell me no, or will you tell me yes? You gotta go overboard for someone someday. Believe it or not, it's bound to be. As long as you're not in love with anyone else, why don't you fall in love with me? Why do you try to make me guess? Now will you tell me no, or will you tell me yes? Don't you know it's bound to be? As long as you're not in love with anyone else, why don't you fall in love? Why don't you fall in love with me? See here, you darling, such and such. See here, I love you very much. Someone someday, believe it or not, it's bound to be. As long as you're not in love with anyone else, why don't you fall in love with me? And many, many thanks. Now, men, a letter from Captain R.S. Saunders at APO 863. Dear Command Performance, there's one voice that I would like to hear above all others, the sound of a baby's cry. That would be welcome music to many of us who haven't heard it for many months. At least I know the sound of my baby's voice would be a thrill beyond description. Well, Captain, it's quite a coincidence. Command Performance is a universal program, and right at this time, your baby speaks a very universal language. Listen. For the personal appearance of that star, we thank the radio engineers. Apropos of the same topic, hundreds of you have written to Command Performance asking Virginia O'Brien to sing Rockabye Baby, as only she can sing it. So here she is, Virginia O'Brien.
Rockabye Baby on the treetop, when the wind blows, the cradle will rock, rock, rock it, baby. Rockabye Baby on the treetop, when the wind blows, woo, your little cradle will rock, oh, rock it. When the bough breaks, new cradle will fall. Down will come my baby, my baby, my little baby. Down will come my baby, baby in the cradle and all. Go to sleep, go to sleep, go to sleep. Close your eyes and go to sleep while Mammy tries to sing a lullaby. Lullaby, lullaby, Mammy's gonna rock you to sleep, lullaby. me, Malcolm.
Thanks, Virginia O'Brien. Virginia will be back in a moment with another song that you've asked for. But now we're calling the Canadian Bomber Boys and Sergeants Patch, Clark, Whalen, and Vatch with good old 426. And Bill Love, a Detroit American in the Canadian Army overseas. And Hollis A. Smith, up there in the medical dispensary at Argentia. Hope that leg is improving, Hollis. And Mr. Dyson at Maidstone, Kent, in England. We're very proud that Command Performance helps you to feel closer to us over here. For Corporal Travis at APO 802, and Jerry Oppenheim and the men at 946, and Corporals Page and Eager with the Royal Air Force in West Africa, it's the hot violin of Eddie Saul, backed up by his entire orchestra, Cigoin in Rhythm. And we'll run a second heat in just a moment. Goodness, three orchestras here tonight. Well, right here, men, Command Performance fills orders from hundreds of you, including Sergeant Williams at 962, L.J. Farina at Fort Shafter, Sergeant Weston at Oahu, the New Harlem Grove Trotters in North Africa, the Bama Boys in the British Isles in India, and from three Hoosiers who've become proud fathers since leading Indianapolis. The orders being for the combination of that beautiful old song, On the Banks of the Wabash, and the one and only Mills Brothers.
The moon was shining bright along the Wabash. From the field there comes the breath of new mown hay. Through the sycamore the candlelight are gleaming. On the banks of the Wabash, from the fields there come breath of new morning. Through the sycamore, the candle lights are gleaming. On the banks of the Wabash, far away, oh, the moon was shining bright along the Wabash. From the fields there comes the breath of new morning. Through the sycamore, the candle lights are gleaming. On the banks of the Wabash, far away, on the banks of the Wabash, far away.
Brothers, that was very, very sweet. It's a hello next to the Chow Hounds at APO 948. Pete, Yarbo, Windy, Kirsch, Porky, and Doy. To Carol and the gang in Barracks 149 down there in the Caribbean. For many thousands of you men of the USA who write to Command Performance, telling of the wonderful friends you're making in the great Latin American nations to our south, here's still another band you've asked for, playing one of the current hit songs, Eddie LeBaron and his orchestra, and Brazil. you, Eddie LeBaron, and your orchestra. Well, men, that special girlfriend of yours is back again. Before she sings another of the songs she made famous in pictures, I think she'd better catch up on some of her correspondence. Front and center again for Virginia O'Brien. Come on.
Thank you, Jeanette McDonald. Love to the Fuzzy Wuzzy Bunch in Australia. Thanks to Ray Daves, Rex Arnold, and the gang at APO 944. Yes, Ray, this will be for Adeline, too. My best to that Eagle Squadron boy in County Kildare and Canadian Brady. That goes for you, too. Hello, Given and Company at APO 845. I'll send that picture and one of Betty Hutton, too. But make up your minds, blondes or brunettes. And A.J. Stessful at APO 40. The guy's in the infantry is top man around here and don't think he isn't. But all of you are darn swell to write to me all those letters, and while you're out knocking out Nazis and Japanese, I'll keep on knocking out tunes to fill up your spare time. And here's one on account of you ask for it. Captain? Carry me back to old Virginia. There's where the cotton and the corn and taters grow. No place on earth do I love more sincerely than old Virginia, the state where I was born. Carry me back to old Virginia, that's my home. There's where the cotton and the corn and taters grow, mostly corn. There's where the birds warble sweet in the springtime. There's where this old lonely heart I'm long to go. There's where I labored so hard for old Massa, day after day after day in the fields of yellow corn, more corn. No place on earth do I love more sincerely than old Virginia. Not Kentucky. Than old Virginia. Virginia, that's the state where I was born. See?
Thank you, Virginia O'Brien. It's a shortwave call here to 23 Jersey men down in the Caribbean with a bombardment unit verbally camouflaged as Robin's Country Club. And hello to G.I. Joe Canata. and the censor who approves your request with a big definitely for 825-961, for Box 17 at Pearl Harbor, and for Bill Bailey from Bellingham, Washington, now in London. It's a return command performance for Eddie South and his orchestra, doing the St. Louis Blues.
Thank you.
That rendition of St. Louis Blues by Eddie Smith South and his orchestra, but hundreds of you from pole to pole have asked me to sing the Ave Maria, and I should like to do it for you now. And I want to tell Clive Waite down there in Belize, British Honduras, that I'm singing it for him and my Captain Jean Raymond somewhere in England. And Captain Dunkel at the Air Base Hospital at APO 845. And Sergeant Troyer, it's for you too. But especially it's for one of Uncle Sam's Marines, Private Gregory of Harlan, Kentucky. And every Marine at Vigay's Island knows the reason why. Gunos, Ave Maria. Thank you very much. And now, this is Jeanette MacDonald speaking for all of us on Command Performance, saying thanks to you men for those wonderful letters you write in care of this station, or Special Service, Los Angeles, USA. Sending the best of the best from over here and asking God's blessing on each one of you over there. Good night.
This program is produced for the men of the Armed Forces of the United Nations by the Special Service Division of the War Department of the United States of America. This broadcast is a part of our English language shortwave service.
My name is Henry Chapp. That's the way it was the week ending January 16th, 1943. Don't forget to find us on Patreon. The name of our Patreon page is World War II on the Air and in Print. The link is in the comments to this video. Next time, we spotlight the week ending January 23rd, 1943. We will listen to World News Today, Fibber McGee and Molly, The Kraft Music Hall with Bing Crosby, and Hello Mom. Well, until then, let's turn off this old tube radio. That's our time machine. Good night. God bless.
This changing world, this changing scene, where is it taking us? What does it mean? As long as we're certain of each other, we know we don't have to be afraid. These changing times, we rise above. We have no time for them. We have our love, and love is the only thing that still remains the same through all this change.